We are called to community from the beginning of creation. We first learn this call through the foundational structure of all societies, a social structure that existed since Adam and Eve, the family. The Blackfeet people have always had a strong sense of community and family life. Young Blackfeet come to know their place and role in their society through their participation, role, and place in the family.
Well, certainly your traditional mom and dad and children, but beyond that, the extended family is, for some, numerous brothers and sisters or siblings, which could be anywhere from 5 would be considered a smaller family and 12, 13 would be the larger family. Any of those that take on the role of providing for you are considered aunties and uncles. So if a cousin is older than you and they take on that role, then they instantly become your aunt and uncle rather than your cousin. As far as cousins, rather than seeing it as first, second, third, fourth, fifth cousins, we are related here. So we are either related or we're not, and most of us are related here. That, I think, makes for a closer connection, closer type of relationship that we have with one another. So that makes for even a larger extended family.
Their culture places a supreme emphasis on the family, though their understanding of family is generally much larger than mainstream American society. It's not uncommon for Blackfeet to count their cousins by the dozens. And while blood relations remain the primary family connection, family status can also be founded on age or role. For example, you will hear many Blackfeet children refer to an older cousin or other family member as auntie. This endearing title has little to do with actual blood relation, but rather acknowledges and respects the older woman's motherly role in their upbringing. The early Christian church existed and thrived in communities not unlike the Blackfeet tribe of the past and those of the present.
So historically, we raised each other, we took care of each other's needs, we didn't think individually. We thought of others before we thought of ourselves. We were definitely tribal, and so we couldn't survive without each other. That remains today. We do not survive without each other, so it's about connecting to one another, and it's about that relationship. And it's about taking care of each other.
Because we all live in organized structures of community, it is also our right as humans to work, to contribute, and to participate in our communities, not just from a spiritual, but also from an economic standpoint. Again, in this principle, we see the connection to the other pillars, namely the life and dignity of the human person. The church teaches that the economy must serve people, not the other way around. Work is more than a way to make a living. It is a form of continuing participation in God's creation. If the dignity of work is to be protected, then the basic rights of workers must be respected. The right to productive work, to decent and fair wages, to the organization and joining of unions, to private property, and to economic initiative. The right to work is intimately connected to the right for workers to provide for their families and to give back to their local community, especially by giving to the poor. But just like how our free will and choices affect our lives and others, improper social structures can also fall short of this ideal.
And it's hard because, you know, we're family-oriented. Well, what do families do when they get together? They eat. You know, it's hard to get healthy food here. It's more expensive. Healthy food is more expensive than more processed foods, which are more unhealthy. And so when you're living on a limited budget, you buy less healthy food. And so, yeah, we get together and we eat, and we have a lot of death here. And when we have wakes, there's 4 days of eating unhealthy food that, you know, you're gathered around the family and the relatives. And so that's not good for our diabetics. And 85% of diabetics have heart disease. And so you just kind of add to that, too.
This right to work, however, means that we, as children of God, also have a duty to openly and honestly reflect on our economic systems, judging them according to these standards, making changes where needed in order to work towards a just society. As St. John the 23rd said, quote, "In human society, one man's natural right gives rise to a corresponding duty in other men, the duty, that is, of recognizing and respecting that right. To claim one's rights and ignore one's duties, or only half fulfill them, is like building a house with one hand and tearing it down with the other."
Well, one definition of justice is giving to God and others what God and others deserve. So for God, God deserves all that we could possibly give, all of our worship, all of our time, all of our attention. All the credit is due to Creator God for that. And then giving to others what they're due means that each person is made in the image and likeness of the Creator God. So they're due the respect that is given through having that dignity of a human person.
From Pope Benedict XVI, Caritas in Veritate number 63, quote, "In many cases, poverty results from a violation of the dignity of human work, either because work opportunities are limited or because a low value is put on work and the rights that flow from it, especially the right to a just wage and to the personal security of the worker and his or her family."